السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ما شاء الله. I spoke to a brother I met earlier who was a revert. He told me that I'm so happy to see so many people so serious about their faith in the month of Ramadan. And I told him, I said, my brother, do you know that we are actually a true reflection of what a Muslim should be like in the month of Ramadan? And we should be letting that extend outside the month of Ramadan. So definitely in the month of Ramadan, you will notice people who don't pray outside Ramadan as they should, praying with such dedication because it's Ramadan, mashallah. Don't you agree? You see people giving charity more in the month of Ramadan, mashallah. You see people who are usually very temperamental and angry calm down in the month of Ramadan. Don't you see that? Mashallah. You might be one of them, right? I could be too. May Allah bless all of us. We see people at times who are far away from the masjid. They hardly come to the masjid, but they are there every night in the month of Ramadan praying long prayer. Subhanallah. You see people reciting the Quran. You see the music go out and the nasheeds come in. You see the haram relations cut off. Subhanallah. The only problem is some of them cut them off and say, see you after 30 days, inshallah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim. The moon that is going to be cited for Eid does not depict a return to sinful behavior, but rather it is a sign of joy that Allah has given you the opportunity to engage in such dedicated worship that He wants you to be able to say, this is the moon that I've just seen. My life has actually changed forever. May Allah Almighty grant that to us. So this Ramadan, I invite you, my brothers and sisters, to continue with the dedication that you have had in Ramadan, even if it may be one notch lower in the sense that it's no longer Ramadan, but it should never be lower than that to the point where your obligations are forgotten or left out, or something forbidden creeps back into your life. That we should become considerate of. Allah says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. When He speaks about the fast, He says, in order for you to achieve taqwa. What is taqwa? It is the proper connection with Allah. It is piety. It is God consciousness. It is the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wrath and punishment. So we ask Allah to strengthen all of us. Ramadan is a gift. That gift continues right up to the next Ramadan if you really are dedicated. And this is why, if you look carefully, we fast 30 days, 29 days, meaning 1 month. And we're dedicated. People who are engaged in haram, like I said, they quit it because of the sanctity of the month of Ramadan. People actually become more serious with things that they were not so serious about. People who had issues dressing, usually in Ramadan, they are strengthened by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala such that their dress code improves. And here I refer to both male and female. The dress code improves, mashallah. But my brothers and sisters, the whole idea is when you exit Ramadan, look at how the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, tells you, من صام رمضان ثم أتبعه ستا من شوال كان كصيام الدهر. Whoever fasts the month of Ramadan, follows it up with the 6 fasts of Shawwal, will have a reward as though they fasted the entire year. If you look at it and you break it down numerically, you will find that every good deed is minimum multiplied by 10. You fasted for 1 month, multiplied by 10 gives you a reward equivalent of 10 months of fasting. You fast 6 more days, you multiply that by 10, it gives you 60 days. And 60 days is 2 months. So 10 months plus 2 months gives you the reward of the entire year. However, Allah wants you to continue in that beautiful dedication. So you're fasting 6 days of Shawwal. But what is even more authentic is to fast 3 days every month, known as Ayyamul Bidh. The 13th, 14th, and 15th of the lunar month, we are advised to fast that. Multiply by 10, you get a reward of having fasted the whole month. Another thing that is absolutely authentic is the fast of the Monday and the Thursday. So if you love Ramadan and you enjoy the way Allah has kept for you a season wherein you polish yourself, then you can continue with the fast that may not be compulsory, but it will indeed polish you to a new level where I'm no longer fasting because it's an obligation, but I'm fasting because of the love of Allah. I enjoy it. I want it. I need the reward. And I want to improve and polish myself such that Allah become pleased with me and I can earn paradise. Today, in order to shed a few kilos and in order to feel a little bit healthier, when the doctor tells you you should engage in intermittent fasting, we quickly do so. Intermittent fasting. I'm doing, what do they call it? The 16 or the 18-6, isn't it? Or the 16-8 or something of that nature, where so many hours, and we do it for our health. What about your spiritual health? If Allah tells you twice a week, Monday and Thursday, you fast, you get a full reward. May Allah bless you. Forget about having known about intermittent fasting. This is something prophetic. It has something in it for you way beyond the beauty and the uprightness of your own body and health. It goes beyond that to something that is unimaginable. It will carry through all the way to paradise. The hadith says when a person passes away, many things follow that person to his grave, but some things go back, and what comes with the person, his deeds. What are the deeds? I'm going to work on these deeds. I want to pack away as I would with my suitcase when I'm traveling. Put essentials, put things that are going to help you. You want to be careful not to carry unnecessary burdens, because you know if you're going by air, you're only allowed a certain number of kilos or a certain number of pieces. So I cannot take more. I will pack things, but I'm not going to go with empty bags. I need to fill that bag with something. I have a journey far more important than any other journey I'm going to undertake. And guess which journey that is? It's the journey into the hereafter. Subhanallah. What should I take with me? I'm going to take with me the goodness that I've done. Not all of us are scholars. Not all of us have capabilities to be able to teach the deen to someone. But every one of us can do goodness. You can be kind. You can reach out to others. You can stop harming people. You can talk to them with respect. You can share the little you know. We have many of us here who are seated today, influencers on social media, mashallah, with thousands of followers, tens of thousands of followers, millions of followers and tens of millions of followers. Subhanallah. I tell you what, use your platform to encourage people to do some goodness. And you will never regret it on the day of judgment as you meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may notice that one small deed you may have done on that social media platform that Allah blessed you with actually earned you the tipping of the scale on the right side and you went into paradise. May Allah grant us Jannah. This is the last day or the last few days of Ramadan, right? The last few hours, let's say, of the month of Ramadan. I tell you, my beloved brothers and sisters, call out to Allah. Ask Him, Allahumma inni as'alukal Jannah. Oh Allah, I ask you to grant me paradise. Allahumma innaka afuwun tuhibbul afwa fa'fu anni. Oh Allah, you are forgiving. You love to forgive. So forgive me. We want to achieve forgiveness. We want to really achieve something unique and amazing. When we've achieved forgiveness and we're serious about seeking that forgiveness, we will feel a change in our lives. We will feel a little bit more dedicated to prayer. We may not have been prior to Ramadan. Ramadan came because of the effort we pushed ourselves to make. The blessing of Allah is outside of Ramadan. I promise you, He will give you a push in order to fulfill the salah, tasting the sweetness of that prayer. The minute you taste the sweetness of recitation of Quran, I promise you, you will be reading it on a daily basis. People say, but I don't have time. One miracle of the Quran, which is tried and tested, is when you do not have time and you make the time to read a portion of the Quran, Allah gives you even more time through your day, and you wonder, how come I have so much of time? But it's because you made time for Allah, who is the owner and creator of time, guess what? He spaced it out for you and blessed you in that particular time. You achieved 20 things during a time frame that you would only have achieved maybe 10 or even less. Why? Because you started your day with a recitation of the Quran, even though life might have told you, you don't have time for this. May Allah forgive us. May Allah forgive us. I can never say I don't have time for my Maker, because I'm going to ultimately return to Him and He's going to ask me, how did you use your time? That brings me to something very important. Did I not say the last days of Ramadan, let's take them seriously. If we were not so serious in the previous days, now is the time to become even more serious. Let's engage in worship tonight. Enjoy the acts of worship. What are the different types of worship we can engage in today? Number one, seeking forgiveness of Allah, praising Allah, remembering Allah. The adhkar, that which comes to your tongue from the words of praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, declaring His glory and so on. Those are all important ways of worshipping Allah. Similarly, the pillars of Islam, we will keep on repeating our shahada. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, or la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The power of the statement is such that on the day of judgment, when it is put on a scale, it will be heavier than 99 files of sinful activity that a person engaged in. Each file is from the east to the west. There is a narration known as Hadith al-Bitaqa, the hadith of the card, where a person will be brought on the day of judgment, and as Allah says, He's going to weigh your deeds. That's the mercy of Allah. Imagine Allah says, I'm going to weigh your deeds. You got more good deeds than bad, you go to paradise. You got more bad deeds than good, you have none other than yourself to blame. Imagine if there was no scale and every bad deed you did, you would have to go into hellfire. Allah says, no, we will forgive whomsoever we wish. If you've done more good than bad, we just look at the scale. If it's tipped on the right side, you go to Jannah, paradise, because you did better. Imagine, that's Allah. So keep on doing more good deeds, because when your deeds that are good are more than your deeds that are bad, you already have reserved your place in paradise. So the scale is such that, subhanallah, we go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with beautiful deeds, and we come to Him with so many different things. I was mentioning this hadith where a person is brought and all his sins are being weighed, his deeds are being weighed, and he has 99 files filled with sin, each file from the east to the west, and it looks like there is hopelessness, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is fair and just. Once in his life, sincerely, in an upright way, he uttered with firm conviction and belief that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger. And you know what? The hadith says, when that card where this is written is placed on the right side, it becomes heavier than those 99 files on the other side. Surely it's an act of worship to repeat this shahada so often. Similarly, what is an act of worship is the pillars of Islam besides the Hajj, right? The Hajj, you have to do Hajj or you have to fulfill the pilgrimage during a specified time in the month known as Dhul Hijjah. But if you take a careful look, there is something called the minor pilgrimage or the Umrah. If Allah has given you the means, in Ramadan, try to go for Umrah. As packed as it may be, there will be a space for you. There will be a space for you. Why? Because the reward of doing Umrah in Ramadan is equivalent to doing Hajj with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to some narration, which is authenticated by the scholars. So if you have the means, go. Don't let the crowd make you think, no, it's packed and there are too many people. The blessings descend in a bigger way when there are more people. This evening we are here to worship Allah together. Thousands of us, approximately 15,000 of us. What do you think we're going to achieve? We're all going to be begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us, to alleviate the suffering of our brothers and sisters in Palestine, to grant them victory and protection. That is the main core of our dua tonight. May Allah accept it from us. My brothers and sisters, we are bleeding because they're bleeding. And we cannot sleep in a sound manner because they are struggling and suffering. May Allah Almighty grant ease to them. And may Allah alleviate their struggles and suffering. May Allah grant them victory. And may Allah open their doors. Ameen. So another act of worship, like I said, the Shahada is a pillar of Islam. It is a pillar of Islam. You don't just say it in order to enter the fold of Islam and that's it. But you repeat it on a daily basis. In fact, in your prayer, in your salah, every group or every set of units of prayer, there is an Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. You have to say that. That is your Shahada. You say that in every salah. So it's a pillar of Islam in another pillar of Islam known as salah. And therefore, we engage in voluntary prayer on a day like this, a night like this. We engage in a voluntary prayer in sets of twos, Taraweeh or Qiyam. Qiyam generally refers to standing at night in prayer. The Tahajjud is the late night prayer and the Taraweeh is the early night prayer. In these nights, we do both of them to the best of our ability. Yes, one might argue it's not compulsory. I know that. But why would I not engage in something? It's not compulsory, but I'm going to get a reward that is multiplied in a fashion, in a manner that is unlike any other time of the year. Let me do it for the sake of Allah. If I'm going to read Quran in Ramadan, in the condition of fasting or in the nights that are considered the most blessed nights of the entire year, why wouldn't I pick the Quran up and read a little bit and see the multiplication of the reward pack away as many deeds to be placed on that scale on the day of judgment? And when Allah knows it was quite difficult for me to do that, He's going to reward me based on my intention with my circumstance. When we see one another, what do we see? We see different types of people. Some have beards, some don't, some in hijab, some not in hijab, some this way, some that way. Everyone has their own struggles. You don't know what someone has done and how far they've gotten and where they've come. But Allah knows the struggles. Allah knows your circumstances. Allah knows your condition. And therefore Allah will reward you uniquely based on a combination of everything put together for you. Your reward may be higher than someone who outwardly might be seeming to be more practicing. Because Allah knows your struggle is real. They moved from 90% to 91% in 1 year. And you moved from 50 to 80 in 1 year. You're still behind them, but your movement, Allah knows it. He knows how much you've done. Therefore, never allow the statements of another human being to make you feel that that has some form of connection with what Allah thinks about you. No way. No way. May Allah Almighty forgive us. We have charity, which is a pillar of Islam. Islam is the only religion, and I've said this many times in the past, that makes it a pillar of faith to share what you have with those who do not have it if you have beyond a certain point. The only religion that makes it a pillar of faith for you to share what you have with those who don't have it if you have beyond a certain point, and that is your zakat. So this zakat, you give it. You can give it in Ramadan, you can give it out of Ramadan. But if you were to give beyond zakat, something beyond just the 2%, 2.5%, something beyond that, then Allah will reward you immensely. So much of reward. Give. Anfiq yabna adama unfiq alayk. A secret to earn is to release. Allahu Akbar. Did you know that? A secret to earn is to give. The Hadith Qudsi says, Allah Almighty says, O son of Adam, spend, give, and I will spend on you. I will give you. You want, if you want, what has Allah given you already? Well, take from it and give it to those who don't have. And notice how Allah will shower it on you. Subhanallah. Because Allah's quality of giving is the ultimate giving. Your quality of giving is actually so small. What are you going to give? You're only going to give a portion of what Allah gave you. But the same Allah gave everyone. Do you know when there is a cause? When there is a cause that requires funding, for example, don't think that that cause is going to stop just because I didn't give. Allah puts it in people's hearts to give. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can fulfill it without anyone giving by creating a miracle for them. How many of us, we don't depend on anyone besides Allah. He opened doors of some form of business that we never imagined would happen. That was Allah. How did He do it? He didn't allow you to stretch your hand to anyone else. That's why the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I want to teach you this evening, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect him from haram by giving him sufficiency in halal. And the same we would ask, Allahumma kfini bihalalika an haramik. Oh Allah, grant me such sufficiency in halal that I am protected from haram. Make me happy, quench my desire through halal in a way that I do not go towards haram. What a powerful dua. Ask Allah that, He will give it to you. Allahumma kfini bihalalika an haramik. Oh Allah, protect me from haram by giving me the quenching of my desire through the halal. May Allah grant that to us. You make that dua, even marriage becomes easy because Allah gives you halal to fulfill your base desires, which is something natural, by the way. May Allah Almighty help us to do the right thing all the time. And the dua continues, وَغْنِنِي بِفَضْلِكَ عَمَّنْ سِوَاكَ. Oh Allah, make me independent. Grant me richness from you. Make me independent through your virtue in a way that I depend on none other than you. Oh Allah, grant me independence, meaning grant me sustenance, grant me independence through your virtue, through your gift and your favor in a way that I never depend on anyone but you, oh Allah. Ask Allah that and see what Allah does. So the point I'm raising is, on a day like this and a night like this, give. Even if it is a pound, a dollar, two, five, ten, depending on your capacity, whatever you can. And wallahi, if you do it with the right intention, you will notice within a short span of time, Allah multiply your wealth. مَا نَقَصَ مَالٌ مِنْ صَدَقَةٍ. Nobody's wealth has ever become depleted because of a charity they gave. If anything, it was multiplied by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah grant that to us. So we have the prayer, we have the shahada, we have the zakah, and guess what? We are fasting. These are pillars of Islam. We are fasting. The fasting of Ramadan is compulsory. Yes, there are a few exceptions, those who are unwell and those who are traveling. If you are not well, that's the only time a fast outside Ramadan will be equal in reward to the fast that is in Ramadan. When you have not been able to do it for a valid excuse, the sisters on their monthly cycle, when they don't fast in Ramadan and they happen to make it up after Ramadan, that's the only time that you making a fast outside Ramadan and you getting a reward as though you fasted in Ramadan. Allah will not decrease your reward because you had an excuse or you weren't allowed to actually fast. Allah gave you such a discount that He said, I don't want you to fast. I want you to concentrate on other things. May Allah Almighty protect all of us. And this is why even a person on a journey, look at how Allah says to us, giving us a leeway and telling us, if you're on a journey, you can make it up on another day. لَيْسَ مِنَ الْبِرِّ الصِّيَامِ فِي السَّفَرِ. According to a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, there is no righteousness. It's not from righteousness to fast while you are traveling. What this means is, when you know that you are traveling, you have an option to fast or not to fast, and both are equal. Don't think that if I'm going to struggle and suffer while I'm traveling and I'm going to fast because I'm traveling, then my reward is going to be more because I'm righteous. Allah says there's no righteousness. You can fast or you don't have to fast. It's the same because you're a traveler, you're traveling. Yeah, and you make it up after Ramadan. It's not a discount like I'm not going to be making this up because I'm traveling. No, you're traveling. One brother comes to me and tells me, you know, sometimes when you learn a little bit and you haven't learned a bit more, you tend to become confused. When you're confused, please ask those with knowledge. He says, I read a hadith saying we're all travelers on earth. That means I have a discount all the time. I said, well, if that was the case, we would be reading shorter salah all the time and hardly anyone would be fasting, because when are you going to make it up? Perhaps in Jahannam. May Allah forgive us. That's such a wrong idea. Such a wrong idea. I told him, brother, I hope you're just joking. He says, well, I'm just looking for a way out. I said, don't. A true believer looks for a way in, not a way out. I want to know, how can I fast in a proper way? What should I do? What shouldn't I do? The other day, someone told me, you know what? We allow 10 minutes more in case perhaps maybe the timing might be a little bit wrong, you know. So we give a leeway of about 10 minutes. I said, my brother, 10 minutes is too much. Because when Allah tells you eat now, you can't say, well, the sheikh at my masjid told me I can't, I've got to wait for 10 more minutes. You can't do that. Allah says, eat now, the sun has set, it's over, you eat now. Whether the sheikh in your masjid says, wait for a minute or not, that's not going to be an answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I tell those who make up these calendars, you know, the calendars made by a human being, the timetables, I say, my brother, don't give leeways, because Allah said, this is the minute. You can't come up and say, but I know a little bit better, I'm going to give one more minute, just in case. Allah knows the just in cases, subhanallah. You stick to what Allah has said, and inshallah you are right. May Allah Almighty help us and grant us goodness. You follow what I'm saying? So my beloved brothers and sisters, outside of Ramadan we're going to fast. In Ramadan we're going to try and engage in all these beautiful acts of worship. Guess what? I've already overshot my time. But nonetheless, these are just few words of encouragement. Look, my brothers and sisters, cry to Allah, beg Him to meet your needs. But while you're doing that, don't be selfish. Don't just ask about yourselves. I told you earlier, tonight we're dedicating it to our brothers and sisters in Gaza, and we're going to pray for them and ask Allah to help them, to grant them victory and goodness and success. And indeed, our problems and issues, while we do have them, they are diminished in the face of the problems that they have out there. And in other countries and other places where our brothers and sisters are struggling, some we know, some we don't know, some we may never know. But trust me, when you are more concerned about others, your problems are diminished. If you have issues, one of the ways of helping yourself is go and volunteer with a charity and go and help people with bigger issues than yours. And you start realizing, wallahi, I've got no problem. I've got nothing. Whatever I have is actually a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because then we compare our lives with those who are in a far worse situation than ours. That's what Ramadan is all about. To change yourself. To change the way you look at things. To become compassionate. To reach out to others. To change your life. To connect with Allah. To be interested in the life of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. When a lie is said about someone, it spreads very quickly. But it's our duty to find out the truth, which takes a little bit more time, and you need to make a bigger effort. May Allah Almighty use us to find out always what the truth is and then to follow it. And may Allah bless all of us. I really would like to welcome you all this evening. And I really would like to ask Allah Almighty to make it a successful evening where we all enjoy the great act of worship known as iftar together. And we pray for one another, and we feel the love for one another, and we may Allah Almighty grant us forgiveness before we get up from our places this evening. Ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.